Who is the most evil character you've played in D&D, either as a player or a DM? And did you enjoy playing as this character? Part 1. I typically do not play evil, so when I do, I take it to the extreme. No, not stupid evil, but diabolical evil. Now, this example is not in Dungeons & Dragons, but in D20 Modern. Every year, my gaming buddies and I descend on Mount Rainier for what we call RPG Camp Fest. We normally pick a system we are not using at the moment and dive headfirst into it for a 3-day weekend of sun up to 3 a.m. gaming goodness out in the most beautiful place in the world. This example happened over one of those Camp Fests. Metabot serial number, something, aka Mike, was a metabot assigned to a vault. Think Fallout. After 200 years, there was a problem with the vault's cooling system, and the cryostasis tubes that he was responsible for failed. Mike stayed in the vault till the bitter end. In the futility that occurred in the vault, Mike developed a plan to replace the power core in his vault to fulfill his mission. He opened the vault to venture out into the wasteland to find a suitable power core. Mike was an android, with the looks human trait. He had all the bells and whistles you can think of for a battlefield medic. He had a cloaking device, maglev feet, insane medic abilities. He was also trained in mechanical repair and stuff like that to fill in where he was needed. What I did not tell the rest of the group made Mike the most fun to play. After being locked in a vault, he developed the spontaneous algorithm trait that allowed him to rewrite some of his coding. This is how he left the vault. He used fuzzy logic to try to save his mission. One other part of this was Mike had no weapons besides a stun baton. He was a medic, and medics are not allowed to use guns. It was not part of his programming to ask for a weapon. So when another player looked at me and said, "You don't have a gun?" I shook my head. He handed Mike a gun and showed him how to use it. Turns out, Mike really, really liked using the gun he was given. And then someone gave Mike a grenade and told him to use it. Mike liked grenades more than guns. But I am getting ahead of myself here. The important part is, Mike was given the key to use a weapon and was issued the command to use it to kill people. I never came out and said he was not allowed to use guns, but I implied it many times. I was not issued a weapon. The GM was very smart and he picked up on it. Slowly, I reprogrammed myself to use weapons to kill people. I treated Mike like a baby that didn't know anything besides medical stuff and what he was shown. Mike spent a lot of time locked in a vault with only himself to talk to. He liked creating robots to keep him company. This experimentation in programming and building led to him developing a hidden god complex. He wanted to create life. So studying humans was a way to understand life. At every step, I twisted something the group did into a lesson for Mike. And at times, I would ask questions for clarity, like, "So I did a good thing blowing up the bad guy's car?" And the DM would often say things like, "You guys get the feeling his character is actually enjoying this," or, "What he is doing is not good." Fully aware that I was turning to the dark side of the alignment spectrum. But no one corrected me. I made it very clear that all they had to do was tell me what I did wrong, but no one corrected it. They even let me torture a guy for info. We raided a bandit camp, and I rigged all the bandits' vehicles to explode. Mike jumped the gun and blew them all up before we had all the hostages safe. This led to the deaths of some hostages. And the group was very happy being able to save some of them, eggs and omelets kind of thinking. Mike liked making things explode, and it was okay to kill a few good guys if the bad guys all died. So at the end of the game weekend, I had turned from a helpful medic to a vengeful murder machine that likes to torture and try to interface man and machine to create new life. The party knew I was doing experiments, but only the DM knew to what extent. But no one looked in on it. I even invited PCs down to my lab to see it, and they declined. No one questioned the homicidal maniac growing in their midst. In the end, we caught up to the big bad evil guy, and I captured him in a net and subdued him. Then turned on the party when they wanted to hand him over to some law enforcement. He was mine, and I was going to lock him in a dungeon and do horrific things to him for as long as I could make him live. He was a political figure who was playing us for fools. "Who is going to stop me?" I asked, looking around the party. I had a shotgun and some grenades. No one could defeat this android, and they knew it. It so gradually shifted to evil that the party was actually in awe of how subtle it was. And now I was ready to defend my catch with zeal. They tried talking me out of it, but it was too late. I was too far gone. With the knowledge gained from my experiments, he would be able to make a new breed of android. I took the bad guy, his minions, and a prototype power core and disappeared into my vault to create a new perfect soldier. Evil does its best to not be noticed. Evil learns early that if you are caught doing evil stuff, it is really bad. True evil starts with the best intentions and then makes a left turn at Albuquerque, setting on the path to the abyss. Each event that led Mike to become evil was not enough on its own. It was the sum of all the parts. He started out neutral and not being able to ask for a weapon. I made that very clear without saying it. Then he was taking his own guns from people he killed. Then he started making his own weapons. And because the research was beneficial to the group, no one questioned it when they should have. As a rule, I don't play evil characters, but there was a level 20 D&D 3.5 game at a convention once that required it, so I decided to do it with flair. I played Bob. Bob was really a Black Aethergaunt, which is a race that used to inhabit the Prime Material Plane thousands of years ago before they fled to alternate planes, but hungrily, nastily want to take the Prime Material Plane back. They have a racial plus 20 intelligence bonus. You can't play them before level 20 because the first 20 levels go into paying their racial level adjustment. Fortunately, they can cast as a 17th level arcane wizard, so you can get by with that. Oh, and they're hideous looking. So, Bob had a backstory. Bob had figured out his race's problem because Bob had racial maximum intelligence, magically enhanced by the generous magic equipment budget the DM had specified in the game description. Bob had 56 intelligence. Bob knew the Aethergaunts would never reproduce fast enough to reconquer the Prime Material Plane as things stood, so the inhabitants of the Prime Material Plane would have to be coaxed and cajoled to destroy themselves. That was Bob's agenda. Black Aethergaunts can mentally dominate others 3 times per day. To avoid arousing suspicion, Bob would mentally dominate an innocent young blonde girl in a light blue frock, cast Reduce Person on himself, then hide in a specially made steel chest with peepholes in it, lashed to the top of a mule. The little girl would lead the mule around. The little girl also carried a pet rat and a stick that kind of looked like a wand. Bob wore a hat of disguise to look exactly like the little girl and would occasionally use a magic item to switch places with the little girl. He didn't have to very often though, because he could just make her say whatever he wanted to say. Anyway, she was his spokesperson, pretending to be the wizard. So Bob was part of a party of 20th level evil characters incentivized to go to a magical portal and enter another realm. Naturally, we get attacked, first by a bunch of giants, which the other party members dispatched pretty easily, and then were charged by 3 Valkyrie on horseback, wielding lances. The Valkyrie were high-level paladins with amazing protections from their deity. Very tough. However, the Game Master had forgotten what I'd told him about my character's usual body double situation, so the Valkyrie charge went something like this. GM, the Valkyrie hits AC. Bob, it hits. GM starts rolling dice. Okay, the Valkyrie does damage in the amount of. Bob, calmly, it doesn't matter. GM, a bit confused, but it adds up to. Bob, calmly, paste. There's nothing left but red paste and a tattered blue frock. How does your paladin's deity feel about her having just slain an innocent? GM, lightbulb finally coming on. Oh, wow. All the paladin's protections suddenly disappear. She now seems very old. All the other players and or their characters were horrified. They said, you did what? Bob, calmly, it was logical. Bob, I attempt to mentally dominate the paladin. Rolls. GM rolls. Without her massive protections, you succeed. Bob, I always wanted a pet paladin. Now, I have a new spokesperson. So, you know, that part was kind of fun. The problem with playing in that party was that everyone else was playing an evil character too, and there was some genuine inter-party conflict. Some were just greedy mercenaries, but one was a pretty antisocial assassin with something like 5 racial templates and a stealth roll that was plus 60 or something. He could literally walk through walls and floors too. At one point, he takes issue with the party mage. The assassin might have failed a will save and had no choice, but the player was being kind of harsh about it, and the assassin phases into the floor to prepare to sneak attack the mage. I reserve my move. You see, Black Aethergaunts also have a racial ability called Total Vision, where, basically, they see everything within 30 feet, no matter what. So when the Assassin of Shadow and Darkness rises up with a stealth roll of about 70 to do a spring attack behind the mage, which I'm pretty sure will be a one-shot kill, I not only automatically see the assassin, I have a wand with quickened true strikes on it, which I cast. Then I cast Disintegrate on the assassin. Between my 56 intelligence and the assassin having given up a bunch of hit dice and save bonuses for their racial templates, it was 34d6 of Thou Shalt Not Exist. I'd like to say the player handled it well, but he did not. I had a wish scroll I was going to use to bring him back if his spirit promised to behave, but some wonky thing about his character construction meant he literally couldn't be wished back, so oops. Otherwise, compared to all the murder hobo stuff most D&D parties do, and good and bad often loosely equating to us and them, the rest of the game wasn't that different than usual. I'm not allowed to play evil characters anymore. Lord Xavier Shratvladin was a good man, a paragon. strong, healthy, wise, and exceedingly charismatic. Upstanding supporter of the crown, a patriot, really. Wealthy and used his wealth gathered from many adventures to invest in various businesses and urban renewal projects. Indeed, he slew a red dragon for the sole purpose of funding a sewer system, simply because he found the filth and squalor of the poor disgusting. He was also a pederast and had 3 underage lovers. Actually, his alignment was lawful evil, emphasis on the lawful. He didn't have time for the moral squabbles of weaker people. Thing was, he did, in fact, use the money from 90% of his adventures to fund various businesses throughout the capital, and yes, actually did kill a red dragon to fund public works. This got him access to the king, an elevation to duke status, and marriage to the king's daughter. No, he didn't kill the king. That would be regicide. The nerve. No, he killed the king's heir because he was a lout that wanted to go off on crusades against evil hobgoblins. He became best friends with the new king's heir. So the rest of the party were necromancers, cultists, rapists, murderers. Yawn. Xavier was a monk. He never thought of himself as a monk. No, he liked the mental focus, the physical regimen, and the fact that he adventured in a gentleman's suit and monocle, and not smelly armor. He was also a gentleman, and a politician, and a pedophile. Because a child you take to your bed is likely not an assassin trying to kill you in your sleep. Just to be clear, the GM actually demanded we come up with something depraved for each of our characters. I just went through the effort of rationalizing mine. And it became a wonderful character interaction when one player threatened to kill his trio of nymphs, and Xavier snapped his neck with one attack. He got better. And if you're curious, the GM rolled the following stats on 4d6. RR1. 18, 18, 17, 16, 18, 18. I was a scary, scary monk.